so let's continue this. If you get the answer, let me know. Lego. Work energy on the rigid body. Okay? So we are going to apply work energy theorem, which is what? W is equal to, you remember? U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. This I have to apply on the rigid body. Okay? So, we know work done is what? Force into displacement of the point of application of the force. Okay? And I need to understand how to write the potential energy and kinetic energy. Alright? So, let's take one by one how to write the gravitational potential energy for the rigid body. Gravitational potential energy. Click on. Suppose this is the rigid body. Okay. This is M1 at a distance of H1, M2 at a distance of H2. Like that, there are different point masses. So total potential energy will be what? M1 H1 plus M2 H2 plus M3 H3 and so on. I have to add up all the point masses potential energy on the rigid body. Logical, right? So potential energy total M1 G H1, assuming G is constant, okay, M1 G H1, M2 G H2, and so on. So it will come out to be equal to summation of MIHI into G. This is the total potential energy. Getting it? Okay. Now assume your y-axis in vertical direction. Let's say this is y-axis. Fine. So your HI is what? YI, y coordinate. Okay. So this is summation of MI YI into G. Potential energy of a particular point mass can be negative. Suppose rigid body is still here. So the y coordinate will be negative, so automatically consider the potential, negative potential energy also. This is my reference line, zero potential energy, which we all always draw horizontal line, right? Wherever we write the potential energy, we draw horizontal line for the gravitation. Now, I know that summation of MI YI divided by summation of MI, this is what? Y center of mass, or let's call it as H center of mass, height of center of mass. Got it? It could be negative also. Center of mass could be here. Okay? So this will give me summation of MIY is summation of mass into YCM. This comes out to be, please stop talking, MGH center of mass. This is how you write potential energy. This equation is still valid for rigid body, but I don't know how to write the potential energy and how to write kinetic energy for rigid body. Just now I have learned how to write the potential energy. So now I can write U2 and U1. Alright, got it? Now let us try to find out how to write the kinetic energy. Okay, kinetic energy of a rigid body. Why we are doing it separately? Because rigid body can rotate, and when it rotates, every point will have different speeds and velocities. Okay, so I need to add up all the masses, velocity half m1 v1 square plus half m2v2 square. Like that, I have to add up all the kinetic energies of all the point masses, right? The way we have done for the gravitational potential energy. Okay? Write down kinetic energy. This is the third class of this chapter. Then I need one more class. So we have spent 1 month on rigid body dynamics, system of particles in rigid body. Kinetic energy of a rigid body. We'll take different cases. Case number one is, let's say, fixed axis. Please write down. Fixed axis. So I'll first find out the kinetic energy for the fixed axis. How to write? Let's say this is the rigid body, and this rigid body is rotating about this fixed axis. Angular velocity omega. There are masses R1, M1. Like this. Okay. So kinetic energy, total kinetic energy is half m1 v1 square plus half m2 v2 square and so on. Got it? V1 is what?
Omega r1.
Omega R1. Why I am writing in terms of omega? Because omega is fixed for entire rigid body, right? So I can write it as half omega 1. Please write it as just okay. Take it. So V1 is what? Omega into R1. This is what you'll get. Okay. So this is half m1 r1 square plus m2 r2 square and so on into omega square. What is this bracket term?
I
about fixed about the fixed axis. This will be equal to half moment of inertia about the fixed axis into omega square. So if there is a fixed axis, you don't have to do anything. Just write half I about fixed axis into omega square. Okay? This is the case one. What if it is not even rotating? Everything is just moving with velocity v.
Half
mv square, simple. It is as good as a point mass. So that we are not considering at all. Any doubts? No. Now case 2. The axis is translating. Okay, rotation plus translation. This is the rigid body. Let's say it rotates with angular velocity omega and the center of mass is going with VCM. Okay? Any doubt? This is generic case. Yes or no? Alright? So velocity of a point which is here, which is at a distance of R1 will be what? VCM plus omega R1. This will be the velocity. Yes or no? Okay. And I am assuming my y-axis to be this. This is, let's say, x-axis and z-axis comes out, let us say. Center of mass is my origin. okay? This is V1, and it will not be as simple as this. It will be a vector sum actually. R cross omega plus VCM vector. But we are doing it in a simpler way. Are you getting it? So kinetic energy will be equal to what? Half m V1 square. So half m into VCM plus omega R1 whole square. This is the kinetic energy of the mass 1. So like that there will be different masses. So total kinetic energy will be what? Summation of half mi VCM plus omega ri square. You need to prove that this is equal to half ICM omega square plus half m VCM square. Prove it. Done? How many of you done? Total kinetic energy. Plus 2 times of VCM into omega into RI.
Oh, no sir, but this is the vector sum, so that's not what it is.
What?
So this is vector sum of VCM and omega R1.
So what?
So it's under VCM square plus omega R1 square.
And then no, square. They are not perpendicular to each other. VCM and omega R1 are not perpendicular to each other.
Okay sir, but plus, yeah sure. But it's still the vector sum, right?
Correct. So there will be a cos theta factor coming in. Understood that. So there will be multiplied by cos theta. So like I said initially, I am taking it in a simpler way. Okay? Otherwise, there will be a cos factor coming in over here. Okay? So this will be equal to half of summation of mi into VCM square plus summation of mi ri square into omega square plus this is what you will get. See, like we have discussed, r is not a distance. It, you have to consider it with sign. It's like a position vector. Fine. So r can be negative or positive also. So what is this summation of mi ri?
Zero.
This will be zero because summation of mi ri divided by summation of mi is your center of masses location, which is zero. So this term becomes zero. This is what total mass into VCM square. This is ICM into omega square. Okay. So this is what the proof is. Half m into VCM square plus half this. So you can treat it like a vector also. So this, if you want to take it like a vector, V1 will be equal to VCM plus R1 cross omega. Like this. Okay? You can use this. Try doing it like this. Take V1 like this. Anybody try it like this? What will be V1 square then? When you square it, how much it will become? V1 square will be what? VCM square mod of VCM square plus what? Mod of R1 cross omega square, then plus 2 VCM dot with R1 cross omega. Getting it? Dot from the dot cos theta factor will come out. Fine? So when you add up all of this, it will be dot with m1 r1 that will come outside. M1 r1, m2 r2 and all that will come out. come inside the bracket dot with VCM. VCM is a constant vector. The summation can go inside VCM. So VCM dot of M1 R1 plus M2 R2 like that. So it doesn't matter whether it is, we have taken simpler thing so that you understand the philosophy of how it comes. You can do it with the vector also. Okay? Okay, any other doubt? Any other doubt? Tell me one thing. If the axis is translating only, it is not rotating, then omega into R1 or R1 cross omega will be perpendicular to axis or parallel to axis? Sorry, R1 cross omega will be always perpendicular to the perpendicular axis or not?
Yes.
It will be perpendicular to axis, isn't it? So, over here, this term.
If you take translation into consideration, won't there be any omega?
So there won't be any omega.
Yeah.
Which omega is
it? I say only translation.
Not only translation, I am saying translation plus rotation, both. See, this R1 cross omega, you need to understand. See, guys, R1 cross omega square, what it is? Here we have assumed that RI is a perpendicular distance from the axis. When you do R1 cross omega, it will be R1 sine theta into omega. R1 sine theta is actually the perpendicular distance. And in moment of inertia, summation of MIRI square, it is perpendicular distance square. Are you getting it? So your R1, so when you do it, this summation will come out to be MIRI square sine square theta I. RI sine theta I is your perpendicular distance from the axis. Getting it? So see, that is the reason why I don't want to get into too much of detail. Otherwise, I start seeing the blank faces. This is what it is. This is for the ith particle perpendicular distance from the axis. And that is square into mass summation will be your moment of inertia, not RI square. Getting it? Any doubts? No doubts. Okay, so that's it for today. We'll continue next week. We'll finish up this chapter.